Okay, let's pretend.
Welcome to Sunday Assembly. Sunday Assembly Los Angeles. I'm Margo.
And I'm Gina.
And we are a God-free community that celebrates a worldview grounded in evidence and reason.
And we invite you all to join us today as we do our best to live better, help often, and wonder more. So, speaking of living better, you know what would be really great right now?
What, Gina, would be really great?
Do you have a kid around here?
I have a kid.
Oh!
There's my kid.
Nice! Thank you. Cheers!
Cheers!
Happy Mother's
Cheers.
Day.
Happy Mother's Day,
Thank
Gina.
You.
Happy Mother's Day, mothers out there.
So, if you haven't already figured this out, we have a mimosa bar in the back. I want to give a shout out to Sean, who's bartending today. Thank you, Sean. And Neil. So we have mimosa available. We also have non-alcoholic options for that. And it is a fundraiser, so if you can donate generously, that'd be great to the bartender. We'll cover the expenses, and after that goes back to Sunday Assembly. But free mimosas for moms for Mother's Day. Thank you. Our theme today is going to be the hunger for connection. And we're going to talk about all the different ways that we come together in community. So to get that started, I would like to invite the Wondermore Warblers, our Peace Together choir, up on the stage. I want to introduce Paul Svenson from San Diego.
Good morning, LA! How's everybody? I don't believe you. So when somebody says, how are you, you might answer like this. We feel good. Oh, we feel so good. So LA, how are you? We feel good. Oh, we feel so good. Now you gotta do the arm thing on the hood. Ready? So how are you?
We feel good. Oh, we feel so good.
This is a Sunday Assembly hymn. And in the tradition of many old hymns, it was written to a 6/8 tune, because old hymn writers used to write hymns to bar tunes so people would know the melody already. We'll try it for you. Welcome to Sunday Assembly. I look round the room and must say, two familiar old faces and new ones. We're glad that you came here today. Here's your part now. We're glad that you came here today. We're glad that you came here today. Two familiar old faces and new ones. We're glad that you came here. Okay, can we go back and do that verse again? Is that possible? Do we have the technology? Here we go. Welcome to Sunday Assembly. I look round the room and must say, faces and new ones. We're glad that you came here. Sing it out now. We're glad that you came here today. Hey, we're glad that you came here today. To familiar old faces and new ones. We're glad that you came here today. The assembly is over by noontime, but we hope that you don't have to run. We'd really like to get to know ya, so stick around after we're done. Here we go! Oh, stick around after we're done. Stick around after we're done. We'd really like to get to know ya, so stick around after we're done. Now, when we're doing a 6/8 song, if you stand still, your breakfast won't digest. Just a thought. We like to sing songs when we gather, so rock, pop, and ballads we croon. We raise up our voices in verses, and sometimes we sing them in tune. You know, sometimes we sing them in tune. Sometimes we sing them in tune. We raise up our voices in verses, and sometimes we sing them in tune. And when we're all done with the program, And after we sing the last song, introduce yourselves to one another. You won't be a stranger for long. Come on now. You won't be a stranger for long. You won't be a stranger for long. Introduce yourselves to one another, and you won't be a stranger for long. So welcome to Sunday Assembly. We greet you with wide open door. We're certainly glad that you joined us to live better, help often wonder more. Live better, help often wonder more. Live better, help often wonder more. Certainly glad that you joined us to live better, help off. Sing it one more time. Live better, help off and wonder more. Live better, help off and wonder more. We're certainly glad that you joined us to live better, help off and wonder
attention. The warblers aren't leaving. I should have taken that as a clue. Yeah. Why don't you sit down for this one? But that doesn't mean don't sing. Because if you're not singing, of course, then we'll have to stand up again. There's a dark and a troubled side of life. There's a bright and a sunny side too. And though we meet with the darkness and strife, the sunny side we always view. Here's the chorus. Keep on the sunny side, always on the sunny side. Keep on the sunny side of life. It will help us every day, it will brighten all our way, if we keep on the sunny side of life. Though the storm and its fury broke today, crushing hopes that we cherish so dear, clouds and storms will in time pass away. And the sun again will shine bright and clear.
Hey, we did it right.
Keep on the sunny side, always on the sunny side. Keep on the sunny side of life. It will help you every day. It will brighten all the way if we keep on the sunny side of life. So let us greet with a song of hope each day. Though the moments be cloudy or fair, lend a hand to our neighbors always. Let them know they will be in our care.
Let me hear it now.
We've got to stay on the sunny side, always on the sunny side. Keep on the sunny side of life. It will help you every day. We will brighten up our way if we keep on the sunny side of life.
Change keys!
Oh, keep on the sunny side, always on the sunny side. Keep on the sunny side of life. It will help us every day. It will brighten all the way if we keep on the sunny side of life.
If we keep.
If we keep on the sunny side of life.
One more time.
If we keep on the sunny side of life.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, warblers. As the day continues and you have more mimosas, if you at any point feel like you want to join the warblers, that is so invited. Let them up here and start singing with us.
We are a non-tryout choir.
Non-tryout. The tryout is trying. Yeah.
So, the tryout is trying.
So this is my favorite part of the assembly coming up, and that is our member milestones. So we are going to share some things that you shared with us at registration. Do you want to start?
Glad to start. So Catherine Campion moved to Ecuador last year. Catherine, wave your hand. Where are you? She just survived the 7.8 earthquake there. So, and we're glad you're here. And flew back last night to help care for a sick friend. So welcome back.
Hi, Kat. It was Kai's fifth birthday last week, so good parenting right there. We made it to five. Yeah.
And Craig and Megan Enlow, give us a wave, Craig and Megan. Oh, it's their 21st wedding anniversary was on May 6th.
Congratulations.
And then their son Will turned 10 on May 10th. May 9th. You'll turn 10 on May 9th. Yes. Happy birthday.
Awesome. Niels is visiting us for the very first time from the Netherlands. So he's going to be traveling through California until June 30th. So where's Niels? Hi, Niels. Okay,
Niels?
So. Oh, thank you, Galen. Okay, where's my kid? He's been outshone.
Thank you.
I know.
So Sunday Assembly Kids will now convene in the room across the driveway. Anyone who wants to participate in the program can leave with their kids and then come back when they're settled. And we love having families and kids with us. Kids are welcome to stay here, but you can also take them. If you do take your kids to the kids' room, please pick them up right after assembly, and then bring them back for cookies, or fruit, or something healthy. Okay.
Or donuts. Yep. Did anyone else have any other milestones that they wanted to share that they didn't get to turn in? Anybody at all? We take shout outs. Oh, right here.
Terry!
I wanted to thank you all for a really wonderful last couple of years being here. I'm going to give all emotional visits.
Oh, Terry.
We will miss you, Terry, very much. But we wish you well up north.
Yes. Anyone else? Milestone, anything they want to share with the group? Yes.
I got a new job, and I will be working in
the
party. I
can
see
you
at Children's Hospital.
Yeah, awesome. Congratulations. Anyone else? We don't leave anybody out. Okay, and in future, if you have something, give that to Terry to check in, and we can share those in our milestones. All right. So our item drive this month was for the Westside Food Bank. They battle food insecurity and hunger in Los Angeles, so thanks to everyone who brought canned goods and dry goods. We collect those out in the lobby if you haven't found that place yet. Next month, we're going to be collecting for Los Angeles LGBT Center. They collect clothing of all different kinds, so that's listed on our website. You can get more information about that, and we always collect for the Westside Food Bank, so you can bring that anytime.
And we want to thank the over 70 people who participated in the Sunday Assembly line last month. We were able to make over 300 care kits that will be distributed soon.
Yes, that's awesome. Matt Rockel, who you will be meeting later, is going to be leading us on an event with the Greater West Hollywood Food Coalition on the 25th of May. You can sign up on our website or at our community table if you would like to come join us to serve the homeless that night, and we will also be handing out the care kits that night as well. So that's really exciting getting those distributed. So, what time is it?
It's icebreaker time, that's me. Okay. So this is a time to get to know your neighbors and reach out to new friends. So try to find somebody you haven't talked to, somebody close to you, and we'd like you to share a fond memory of your mother or a mothering figure in your life, perhaps a grandmother or a special friend or a mentor. So please go ahead and start, and you will see a shush and desist sign when it's time to stop. Have fun.
really excited to tell you. We have every now and then these comedy fundraisers in Burbank at Flappers. They've been a lot of fun. We've had some really great comics there, and one of them we all particularly loved has agreed to come back today to do a short performance, a little bit more comedy, which everyone enjoys. So I would like to welcome, she's been seen on Last Comic Standing, NBC, ABC, Lifetime. Please welcome to the stage, Shelagh Ratner.
So much. Oh, I guess you didn't realize the hunger for connection would have to do with a microphone this morning. Thank you for putting up the international sign for the icebreaker is over, a wolf putting his snout into another wolf's mouth. I recall that from my days of foreign travel. I drove by the Scientology Center on the way here and thought, God, there's one mistake I didn't make. I love those good days in LA. It's always a positive spin. We're all running and skipping and eating guacamole. And a kid went by me on a skateboard the other day. He said, what day is it? I was like, I don't know, Thursday, but check at the corner. It's like Benjamin Button. We're all just getting younger. I like it. My name is Shelagh Ratner, but my mother liked Irish playwrights and practical jokes, so she spelled it S-H-E-L-A-G-H. So when I went to jury duty in Manhattan and they called Shelagh Ratner, I had no choice but to rise and be counted. It's an awfully long walk when the name or noise Shelagh is made. I was often called Shelagh as a child and moved every 2 years, and I had a lazy eye. So if you're wondering how to make a stand-up comic, why, those are the ingredients right there. That's exactly how you do that. Singing the other day what I would do if I did, I love comedy so much. What would I do if I didn't do comedy? What would my ideal job be? I'd like a job where I don't have to get too dressed up, time to work out every day, meet my basic needs. I want to go to prison. I want to be incarcerated. Doesn't it sound simpler, ladies? Same orange jumpsuit every morning. No snacking between meals because you're tucked away in that cell. Meet interesting people who've killed other people. I don't know, be safe in there. It's sort of getting crazy in the world, isn't it? The White House might become a Trump casino. What is happening? What is happening? I think no one is sticking to their assigned tasks. A bunch of people want Oprah to be a senator. Great talk show host, she's not a senator. Lincoln is not a vampire hunter, you guys. I went out to a Dodger game, you know, who threw out the first pitch? Hello Kitty, what is happening? What is happening? I'll tell you what happened a while ago. They invited the cast of Scandal to the White House press dinner, and that is when the confusion began. Numerous people wanted to vote for Olivia Pope. That's not Olivia Pope, that's Kerry Washington. All right then, I'll vote for Kerry Washington. No, no, we blurred the lines between entertainment and politics, you guys. That's all there is to it. There's too much power given to the reality stars. You know there's gonna be a second NBA draft just for the Kardashians to pick their next husbands? Did you guys know that? I was watching House of Cards the other night and it's shot in this really somber way and Robin Wright is dressed to the nines and it's serious cutthroat politics. What I'm saying is our television shows are taking our politics more seriously than we are. This is what I'm saying to you. Something has gone terribly wrong. When did it become okay to eat sizzling fajitas at the movies? What happened? When I was a kid, you ate some popcorn, you drank a Coke, you tried to be quiet. I went to the movies the other night, there was a dessert cart coming down the aisle. There's a lady behind me getting her eyebrows waxed. There's a woman in the front row adopting a baby from South Africa. Is anybody watching the movie? Anybody? No, we're all checking in to tell you we're at the movies. We're all telling someone we're at the movies instead of being at the movies. I mean, I feel like I do this myself. I live in Santa Monica and the marathon ended there a while ago. I saw a number on the floor, I picked it up. I ran that last two blocks. It felt great, you guys. It felt great, people were high-fiving me. Posted it on Facebook, finished the marathon. Kinda true. I work on a TV show sometimes as a nurse, and let me tell you something. I don't know if anyone here is in the medical profession, but wearing those scrubs is incredibly empowering. I mean, they put those scrubs on me. I felt really good, and then they gave me a stethoscope, and I was like, I can heal people. Really? So I left work one day and went to Cedars-Sinai and did an 8-hour shift. posted a picture of myself on Facebook, told people I'd become a nurse. It really doesn't take much anymore in this country. No one's sticking to their assigned tasks. Everything's upside down. I saw a late night commercial that said become a nurse in 6 months. I did it in 8 hours at Universal Studios, you guys. Come on. I know the theme today is a hunger to connection, and so I want to tell you a good story that I just love telling. It happened to me a while ago. I was not in a great place, and I was feeling very low. A lot of comics just love getting up here and making people laugh, but sometimes there's a terribly dark side when the show is over. And I was lying in bed, and I was feeling low, and I was thinking about this article I had read about Brian Wilson of the Beach Boys, not the pitcher for the San Francisco Giants. And Brian Wilson had spent 7 years in his bathrobe in his beach house with only his therapist. And it was one of those mornings where I was thinking that sounded really good. And I remembered that I had submitted my information to audition to be a mascot for the WNBA LA Sparks. I'm not, of course, in any way qualified to be a mascot. And I got out of bed and I got dressed and I drove down to Marina Del Rey and I auditioned to be a mascot for a professional basketball team. When I got there, there were a lot of long-legged dancers in their 20s. I'm not. I've got a Kung Fu Panda belly, I'm in my 40s. Everything should have said, just run, run from this room. I asked the woman if the mascot costume was available, and she said, why? And I said, I assume you're taping this, and I'd like to at least wear the head so that this tape doesn't get anywhere out in the real world. So the first dancer danced and said he had a Miami dance crew on his resume. The second dancer said that he had been a mascot for the Harlem Globetrotters, and then it was my turn. And they put on Pump Up the Volume, a very popular song at sporting events. And I froze for about 5 seconds. And then because the mascot's a dog, I got on all fours and urinated on a houseplant. I then lay on my back and asked for belly rubs and screamed Candace Parker, who's one of the star athletes on the WNBA Sparks. Obviously, dance is not traditionally a verbal art form. The 45 seconds of my audition seemingly felt like 8 or 10 minutes, finally ended, and the woman said, wow, thank you. And I said, you're welcome. And she kept me for a second interview, which surprised the heck out of me. And she said, I had to talk to you and ask you what made you come here today. And I said, you know, I wasn't feeling great. And I thought, if I stay here at home in my Brian Wilson bathrobe, I kind of know what the day will be like. But if I get out and connect, maybe something will change. And she said, there's no easy way to say this. You are deeply unqualified for this position. But I'd like you to come and do corporate events for the WNBA Sparks and do comedy for us. And I said, I would love that. And so that was a moment where I connected that felt really good. So I'm just saying, if you have a morning and you want to stay in that Brian Wilson bathrobe, get out of bed, do something you're deeply unqualified to do, and connect, because you really never know what'll happen if you just take that ship and change it 1 degree in another direction and try. All right, thanks a lot.
That was amazing. Woof. Thank you, Shelagh. So, so good. So we have our long form speaker coming up, our featured speaker. Today, I'm very happy to announce, is Robert Egger. He is the president and the founder of the LA Kitchen. He has so many great credits to his name, so I'm just gonna mention my favorite one, which he was named one of the top 10 most caring people by the Caring Institute. Pretty killer awesome. So I'd like to welcome to the stage now, Robert Egger.
Thank you so much. Thanks so very much. Good morning, everybody. It's a big old fat pleasure to be here. Happy Mother's Day to everybody. And I'm going to riff a little bit on Shelagh's thing about trying new things because, you know, it's interesting when you reflect on mothers. And I know we've all done that today. And, you know, my mom could not carry a note to save her life, but boy, did she love making a joyful noise. She was a church-going woman. She dragged all 6 kids along with her. And as you can imagine, at a certain phase, I think many of us all went through it, I became less and less interested with going to church on Sunday. But nonetheless, you know, I wanted to make mom happy, so continued to go for a while, and eventually ended up moving on in my life to, you know, moved out at home when I was 17, and I really wanted to open nightclubs. My mother did something that really frustrated my father, Noah. My father was a military pilot, and we had moved, we grew up here in Southern California, and we moved to Washington, D.C., and my pop, you know, this was like the eighth move for our family, and my pop was always trying to sugarcoat these moves for us, and he was saying, in effect, oh, we're going to live in Washington, D.C., and he was really making it out like we were going to be at 1602 Pennsylvania Avenue. You know, we were going to be right next door. We were in Springfield, Virginia. It was like the Beverly Hillbillies in reverse. You know, it was a really, and to a young 13-year-old kid, it was really deeply frustrating. But I grew up here in Southern California dreaming of being a surfer. Two things I really wanted to be so bad I could spit. I wanted to be a hippie, and I wanted to surf. I was 10 in 1968 in Los Angeles here when Dr. King was assassinated and Robert Kennedy was assassinated. That had a profound impact on me. And it really set at a very early age a sense of what I wanted to do with my life. But like many people, I was still just kind of chugging along. But when we moved to Washington, D.C., my mom sat me down when we got there because I was really down. And she said, hey, there's one of my favorite movies coming on. Why don't we watch it together? And we sat down and watched the movie Casablanca. Now, it still remains one of my favorite movies, but it was interesting because literally as soon as Rick came on, as soon as you saw Rick's nightclub, it was crazy because almost instantly I decided I want to be that guy and I want to open a nightclub. And that's all I ever did. I mean, my father used to shake his head and could not figure it out, but suddenly that was like I had this sense of calling. I wanted to open the greatest nightclub in the world. Now, what was interesting about it is I didn't really want to do this for the obvious nightclubby things. I became enamored as a young man with the power of music. You know, as much as people understandably look at the election cycle this year and think, oh, this is the worst cycle, elections have always been heinous. America's always been divided. In 1968 and you know, 1972, they were always really tough years. But I remembered vividly my father had a party once and all of their friends who could not agree on anything political, and in particular were very, very mixed over their attitude about Dr. King and Robert Kennedy and other movements of the day, civil rights, the environmental movement, the women's movement. Yet, whenever my dad put on a Motown record, everybody danced. And as a kid, I became intrigued because the exact same ideas that got Dr. King and Robert Kennedy murdered got people on the dance floor. And I became mesmerized by the power of music, theater, comedy, art. So for me, a nightclub was about how can you keep these really important ideas moving forward. This was going to be my Trojan horse, this idea that you could lure people sometimes who were, in a sense, intrigued but afraid of bigger ideas. Somehow I felt this would be my way of keeping these very critical, important ideas moving forward, that I would have a nightclub and I would disguise really powerful ideas as entertainment. Oprah did it every day. Oprah literally was a preacher. Oprah wanted your soul. But she disguised what she did as afternoon entertainment. She got people to believe that this wasn't an exercise in spirituality. It was just afternoon entertainment. And that's how she got it all under the radar. Now, I was a really good nightclub impresario. I had a great run. And I came up at a time when there was both an exciting time musically for new music, particularly in the late 70s and early 80s with the explosion of, I mean, it was everything. It was reggae, it was punk, it was Sweet Prince. You know, it was Kraftwerk and computer music. It was a glorious time. I also ran jazz nightclubs, and it was fun because I got to see, in fact, I was looking out, there's an old picture of Sarah Vaughan on the wall out there, and as a young man, I worked in jazz nightclubs where I got to meet and work alongside Sarah Vaughan, Oscar Peterson, Mel Torme, the Modern Jazz Quartet. It was a great, fun life, and I was really, for sure, set. This is my chosen path. This is what I was born to do. I'm going to open the greatest nightclub in the world. And then somebody asked me if I wanted to go out with a group of people and feed homeless people out on the street. Now, I know you're thinking, you know, oh, he's about to say, looked in the eyes of a homeless person, cast aside the stilly world of nightclubs. No, honestly, I'm a recovering hypocrite. You know, I should say, every time I say, hello, my name is Robert, and I'm a, because I spent my entire youth dreaming of changing the world with music. Yet, when somebody said, do you want to go out on the streets of Washington, D.C., and serve this rapidly growing ranks of people who were homeless, I said, no. I looked for every possible way to get out of it. You know, I was just afraid. Like so many people, I was burdened by the sense of stereotypes and bigotries, all the things that kept me from crossing this line of doing something not from the safe distance where you could, you know, show empathy with your eyes as you walk by somebody, but to really get close and meet somebody. Like many people, there was a sense of, I don't know if I could do that. So I looked for every excuse to get out of going out on this truck, and inevitably I got pulled out. And it was interesting because I asked to hide my nervousness, where's the food come from? And they said, oh, we bought it at this grocery store. It happened to be the Safeway in Georgetown. I don't know any of you all know Washington, D.C., but it is the most expensive store on the planet. And I'm thinking, wow, that's interesting. I work in an industry that throws away food every single night. And not just nightclubs, but for heaven's sakes, hotels, caterers, universities, hospitals. Wow. Okay, so I'm thinking about that. But then it's fun to be up on this little riser because we ended up pulling up in front of the State Department on Virginia Avenue in between George Washington University and the State Department. And there was this long line of men and women outside waiting in the rain for this truck to pull up, just sitting there huddled up one by one in a dutiful little line waiting. And you know, I was looking out the window as we pulled up and we slid open this long window and dutifully started serving people. And as you can imagine, you know, all of my prejudices and stereotypes rapidly kind of faded away as we had conversations. And I was so intrigued by how many people I met and the conversations we had, yet I couldn't help but have this nagging sense that I was the one being served. That I, in effect, I was up in the warmth of this truck serving people outside in the rain. And I kept looking, and not only that, but at the end of the line, the guy who was the driver of the truck seemed to know everybody by name and was saying, in effect, see you tomorrow night, see you tomorrow night, see you tomorrow night. And I kept trying to actually mind my own business. But at the same time, I just kept thinking about this equation, and I realized, you know, this is kind of charity in America. This is about the redemption of the giver, not the liberation of the receiver. And this was this moment in my young life where, you know, I thought, well, you know, I'm born to open a nightclub, but, you know, maybe I can put some things together here. And I went home that night and put together a little business plan. And it was based on FedEx, but it was this idea, if you could get the restaurants and the hotels and the hospitals, farmers to donate food they hate throwing away, and you can bring it to a central kitchen, you can feed more people better food for less money. But let's get people off the street. You know, instead of viewing men and women out on the street as people who were only in need of services, maybe if we showed a way in which everybody had a role to play, that they could be part of a new solution. If we started a cooking school, we could offer those men a chance, men and women, to come off the street and be part of the solution. And in effect, we could not only serve the line better, but we could shorten it at the exact same time. And then, if you will, repay the restaurants and the hotels that gave us food with men and women who could come and work at their restaurants. So I was pretty proud of myself. I mean, this was a very small little idea, and I kept dutifully going back to all these different groups saying, I've got this great idea. Here's how you can feed more people better food for less money, da, 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 da. And I kept thinking that I was gonna be given the Volunteer of the Year award. I thought for sure that they would say, wow, how could we have missed this? This is such a great idea, thanks. But you know what I heard over and over and over and over again was all the reasons it wouldn't work. Over and over and over again. It was so frustrating. And it was so interesting to watch how people worked so hard to keep this idea at bay, to the point of suggesting to me that while they appreciated the fact that I was young and idealistic, that was suggested that I was naive to think that restaurants would hire someone who was home from prison or who was an addict. And I was like, you've never worked in a restaurant. That's the island of misfit toys. Anybody can get a job in a restaurant. So, brothers and sisters, I had one of those moments, and we've all had them, where suddenly the road splits, and there's no sign that says polka dots and moonbeams this way, I'd turn back if I was you that way. It was just this moment where it's like, I was born to open the greatest nightclub in the world, but somebody should do this. You know, this is just too easy, it's not that hard. So I figured I'd get it going and push it off and go back to running nightclubs. Here we sit 30 years later. And I've been doing this ever since then. But what's been so interesting about it is not only have the businesses I've helped launch produced about 30 million meals over the past 20 some odd years and helped about 1,500 men and women go on to get jobs, but along the way, I discovered a lot of really interesting things. it was fascinating. The model that I had touched on proved to be so much more interesting to people than I anticipated. You know, A, there was this intense curiosity about how much food we threw away, but what was even more interesting, and it started out, one of the very first, we opened up on George Bush Sr.'s Inauguration Day. Who could resist? What media outlet in the world could resist food from the inaugural parties going to homeless people the next day? And media from around the world came. It was fascinating because suddenly I had an onslaught of people who wanted to volunteer, right? So they started coming, and it was interesting because the very first time there was this group of doctors who wanted to volunteer as a group, right? And they came in, and we had this little ramshackle kitchen we had set up on Florida Avenue, and we had one of our very first classes, and we were making this up. No one had ever really trained homeless people before. So it was all made up as we went. And I was sitting there trying to get these doctors and some of the men and women in the first class, and they were mostly men and women who had come out of heroin and alcohol abuse for many years. And I was so worried because I didn't think they'd figure it out how to work together. And I was I was doing everything back then, and I left, and I asked this one guy, Joe, can you get the men and women, the doctors going, right? And as I left and turned around, I looked at both groups, and they were staring at each other, just kind of frozen in their tracks, just kind of staring at each other. And I realized, oh my goodness, this is trouble, because both sides are afraid of one another. You know, to the doctors, Joe was a homeless guy with a knife. And to Joe, the doctors were people almost reinforcing his own sense of negativity about himself, the sense of, why am I trying this? I've messed up everything in my life. This is just something else I'm going to mess up. And I was rushing around trying to get back. But when I came back, there they were all working together side by side, and Joe was teaching the doctors how to cut. And it was a fascinating moment when I realized, this is how we'll fight hunger. It won't be about the food. It'll be about people working side by side. And that became our real agenda. You know, how could we get Washingtonians from all walks of life to come together? And this ended up culminating many times with presidents and the first families coming to volunteer. You know, and here is Barack Obama and his entire family standing. And it was fascinating to see. Here we were in the basement of this giant shelter, and we're doing almost 7,000 meals a day, 7 days a week. And there was, you know, a man who had been in prison most of his entire life. You know, a young kid who had been out on the street, an older person who wanted to volunteer, you know, somebody in our job training program, and the President of the United States, all standing side by side as Washingtonians. You know, this idea, if we work together, look at what we can achieve. But the power of someone and these moments, and it happened consistently, where the President would look over and say, am I doing this the right way? And the power of somebody who had been in prison looking over and saying, actually, no, you do it this way. You know, and that was the power of what we revealed, that everybody has a role, everybody has something to contribute. You know, and this is what really has led me on this journey and kept me really active, because what I discovered along the way is, while it was important to address the issue of hunger in America, I became more and more intrigued by what I felt was this deeper hunger, this sense of this desire to be part of something bigger, this desire to belong, to feel like you were contributing to something. And it seemed to be universal. It didn't matter how metaphorically low somebody was or how high up they were. There was this great sense of longing that I became mesmerized by. And in actuality, what I discovered along the way is that the kitchen became my nightclub. And instead of music, I used food. And I could achieve the same thing. I could get people to these really interesting places where they could see, in the simple act of working side by side, the role we could each play. That in effect, nobody was too far down to be redeemed, and nobody was too high up to help somebody else up. And that's what I've done. Now, I came back here to Southern California for two really very important reasons that I think are very germane to our conversation this morning. As you know from working with Westside, so many of the charities we work with, whether it do food, all that food represents lost profit. Industry, somebody bought it or grew it and they can't sell it, so they donated it. And it's become really, really pressing because for many of the food programs in America, there's this great sense of, this food's not gonna be here forever. It's gonna get, you know, people are getting smarter and smarter and smarter. So the food we have to rely upon is getting fewer and fewer and far between. And the food we do have oftentimes has sometimes really less nutritional content than many of us would like. So some of us started to really explore the idea of, instead of waiting for food to be donated, what would happen if we went out to farmers early and offered to buy food? You know, instead of doing charity, we could open the door to business. You know, and once we did that, we could maybe then resell the food, we could open our own businesses. So when I left Washington, D.C., we were doing almost 12,000 meals a day, half for charitable partners, but the other half, locally sourced scratch cooked meals for DC public schools. Imagine men and women who were serious, men and women who, actually we started our businesses because there were so many men and women who were coming home from prison and nobody would give them a job, no matter how hard they tried. So that idea of, let's start our own businesses, let's show people what men and women can do if you give them a chance. So we had an entire team of people, almost 50 people on the payroll, who were serious men and women home from prison, who were cooking every day and doing school food. And this amazing metamorphosis we saw constantly of how people got really into the task. You know, this idea of, I'm helping to repair a city I helped tear apart when I was younger. You know, the sense of ownership, the sense of meaning. It was so powerful to watch. But anyway, I came here back to Southern California because, again, it's where I grew up. It's a great sense of return. I feel like the prodigal child after 40 years in the wilderness of Washington, D.C. I really wanted to come back to Los Angeles again. And again, there was two reasons. I mentioned food earlier. Coming here, you're at the bottom of the Central Valley of California. It's like the Niagara Falls of beautiful food. You know, every day in America, we throw away about 40% of the food we produce, but half of it is fruits and vegetables that are cosmetically imperfect. So this idea of coming back here and saying, I want to go get all the wrinkled, bruised, bent, broken produce that is currently thrown away and show it still has value. But what's equally interesting, as much as we sometimes really see Los Angeles as a town dedicated to youth, it's actually the largest concentration of older people in America. We have almost 1.25 million people over 65 here in Los Angeles. The number is going to double in 10 years to 2.5 million. And what you can see coming is a generation of people who are going to live longer than they have money in the bank. So I came back out here to be part of what I think is the next great food revolution. How can we feed a generation of older people a healthier meal? But not just feed them, but really reach out and include them. Our motto, basically, wrinkled food, wrinkled people, no waste. You know? But this idea of saying, you know, you're beautiful, you're needed, you have a role to play. You know, this is what interests me. You know, I tell you, man, I look around, some of us in the room, we're all getting to that point, but wrinkles are the new tattoos, man. You know, they represent, this thing that this is the last kind of great waste in America. We push away a generation. The baby boomers represent the deepest well of life experience in the history of the world. No other generation has been this rich, this free, this educated, and will have lived this long, and truthfully had the greatest soundtrack in the history of the world. You know, and every single morning, 10,000 people wake up 70. Every single morning. And that's gonna go on for the next 18 years. And you gotta figure, there's a huge number of those men and women who are looking in the mirror and saying, how did I get so lost? You know, how did I get so tricked into thinking if I just bought more stuff, I'd be happy? And what I see is an army of men and women coming up saying, in effect, I have all this skill, I still have some time, I have this love in my heart, let me find a place, not to go back to the 60s, but to go back to that sense of belonging, to be part of something bigger. What's equally exciting is there's 100 million people under 30 in America, a generation, the most diverse generation in the history of our country, the most technologically advanced, but in one of the greatest social experiments in the history of the world, we raised an entire generation doing service. You know, going to volunteer at places like LA Kitchen or the West Side Food Bank or dozens of other places. You know, we send them off hoping they'll find some sense of place, but what's mesmerizing about them is what we've created as a generation, and I don't want to generalize, but a generation of young men and women who seem so convinced that they need to go out there and find a job that reflects not just, they almost want to merge their spirituality, their lifestyle, and their income. Saying in effect, look, if I can find a job where I not only don't do harm, I do good, sign me up. And that's a powerful, powerful opportunity. So what I see coming is a glorious moment where we can create a real bridge between generations. You know, how can we get old and young working side by side? You know, what was fascinating to me about California, and it happened all over America, but no place more poignantly than here. At the end of World War II, for the first time in the history of the planet, an army came home and didn't go back to the farm. That had never, ever happened. You know, rich men declared war, and the sons and daughters of farmers went off to fight it. And those who were lucky enough came back home and they went back to the farm. And that had never happened before, this through the GI Bill. And that's when we kind of left this agri culture, this sense of connectivity. And I don't want to romanticize that time, but what I find so mesmerizing is there's a younger generation that's trying to find their way back. And you see this all over, and whether it's farmers markets, whether it's the food movement, there's a sense of a longing to return to the sense of connectivity, but it's not about food. It's about community. It's about this deeper hunger that people have, where they want to feel like they're connected again, and they're working towards something really powerful. It's a glorious opportunity, and that's why I've come back to the city where the future comes to happen, to be part of making that happen, to show the power of using food purposely, but also using it in a way that uplifts, includes, empower, engages, and really says to people, you have a role to play. Old or young, everybody has something to contribute. Thank you all very, very much.
Thank you so much, Robert. What an inspiring story, and thank you for sharing it with us. If you'd like to go and work at Robert's Los Angeles Kitchen, we're doing a service project there June 4th from 9:30 a.m. to 12:30 p.m., and we will get to help with reclaiming those bruised and wrinkled fruit, and we can go with young and old and chop and peel and zest and do all of those fun things. So please come. You can sign up at our table, which is right back by the products, or online. So thank you, Robert. And here's Paul back for another song. Do we have the warblers? Will you come on up?
And anybody who's had mimosas? We do have an audition. You have to be able to fog a mirror at 1 inch. And if you can't do that, you can still be in the warblers. So let's do a song from the ever-compiling album called Gone Too Soon for 2016. I think let's stand up. You guys know this one. Still don't know what I was waiting for, and my time was running wild, a million dead-end streets, and every time I thought I got it made, I'd seen the taste was not so sweet. So I turned myself to face me, but never got a glimpse of how the others might see the faker. Much too fast to take that chance. Here we go. Changes turn and face the strain. Changes. Don't want to be a richer man. Changes and face the strain. Changes. Just gonna have to be a different man. Time may change me, but I can't trace time. How many of you thought I used to say it, but I can't change time? Doesn't. That's because Bowie's cool. I watch the ripples swim, change their size, but never miss a stream of warm impermanence. So the days flow through my eyes, but the days seem the same. And these children that you spit on as they try to change their worlds, they are immune to your consultations. They know that well what they're going through. Change and face changes. The pace I'm going. Here we go. Changes. Look out, all you rock and rollers. Change it, turn and face the strain. Changes. Pretty soon you're gonna get older. Time can't change me, but I can't trace time. I said that time can't change me, but I can't trace time. right. David Bowie.
Okay, so that was the perfect introduction for our next speaker. We're going to talk about change, and now I'm going to invite Matt Rockel, who's one of our assemblers, to come up to the stage and tell us about changes in his life as he is doing his best. Come on up, Matt.
Thank you. This week is something of an anniversary for me. 9 years ago, almost to the day, on May 4th, 2007, I packed all of my worldly possessions into a 2002 Volkswagen Jetta and drove across the country. My name is Matt. Some of you may have figured that out by now. And I'm doing my best by being here at Sunday Assembly with all of you wonderful people. While it was definitely the hunger for connection that brought me here the first time in April of last year, it didn't do so without great protest from myself, because I tend to find the most convoluted path towards a simple goal, as you're all about to witness firsthand. No man is an island. I think even the first time I heard that, I thought that's really stupid. Of course, a man is an island. That's how we determine one from the other. It's like the very individualities that we hold dear and make us who we are that, by definition, set us apart into different entities. Every man is an island, but most find themselves in some kind of archipelago. For me, community never really felt like a constant throughout my life. I mean, we all lose people and communities. I'm sure we all have stories. If you're like me and you were raised in a religious community, you may have seen an entire massive community go extinct in a moment. For me, I've been rather lucky in that regard. But for young, stupid 24-year-old me, he noticed sort of a pattern emerging of moments in which his life suddenly became very small. Even before he came home from work one night and his wife had packed her bags and was waiting by the door to leave for good. My world became very small. And more than that, my future was shattered. So I did what any good mid-20s millennial would do in such a situation. I moved back in with my parents. Thank you for laughing at that. They nursed me back to health. And while I tried to figure out what I was going to do with my life, I got a temp job that was supposed to last 3 to 5 weeks. 9 months later, I was at the same job. They had promoted me once, and they were offering to promote me again and give me a full-time permanent position at the company in wholesale lockbox and retail remittance processing. Yeah. Right? So that forced me to take a good, hard, long look at my life, and I did, and I turned in my 2 weeks' notice, and 2 weeks later, I was packing all of my worldly possessions into a 2002 Volkswagen Jetta. And my world got very small again, because I was leaving behind family and friends to come out here, and I didn't even have a job out here. I had two friends, one of whom was gracious enough to rent me his spare bedroom for very cheap while I looked for work in a place of my own, and the other one was willing to help me find some work. I've been out here 9 years. Time flies. But you can do a lot in 9 years, and I've done a lot. I've done a lot of positive things, too. Like, I've done a lot of adult things. I've fixed my credit score, which I only had to do because I destroyed my credit score. I paid off my student loans. I've turned my job I want to do into a little career that's recently started flourishing, complete with union membership. I've lost 50 pounds recently, which I only had to do because I gained like 60 pounds. But I never found a community of my own. Last April, it was my turn to have my bags packed and walk out the door on a relationship. And when I did that, my world got very small again because I wasn't investing in my own community. So when I left, all of the friends that I was very friendly with and were very friendly to me, but were only there because I was friends with my girlfriend went back to what they really were. They were her community. So maybe it was just coincidence that April of last year was the first time I came to a Sunday assembly. I'm sure you all remember me from that meeting. I was the one who snuck in right before it started and left right after it ended. I talked to three people, which I thought was good for a first time. I didn't come back in May, even though I had a great time. I did come back in June, and shortly thereafter, Terry Smith gave a very beautiful and heart-wrenching Doing Your Best, wherein she mentioned that when she was just starting to come to assemblies, she forced herself to come by signing up for a volunteer obligation so that she couldn't back out, and I thought, that's genius. I'm going to do that. And so I did, a few months later. And as soon as I did, then I heard about how they needed help setting up and taking down lights. And I thought, I grew up in a theater, I can do that. I enjoy being backstage more than in the spotlight. And so I came back the next month and I helped set up lights. And I've come back every month and done that. So the inner introvert in me is absolutely terrified and excited to get to know more of you in the future. But my name is Matt, and I'm doing my best by coming to Sunday Assembly. Thank you.
Okay, now I'm crying too. That was beautiful. And we're going to take this moment to move into some reflection. And I'm going to invite Margo up, and she's going to lead us in a loving kindness meditation.
Thank you, Matt. That was beautiful. Okay, get the wiggles out. Roll your arms, your shoulders, and sit back. Sit on your sit bones and your feet on the floor. Just get comfortable and take a deep breath. Breathe in and breathe out. Breathe in and breathe out. And close your eyes if you're comfortable with that. As you're breathing in deeply, getting comfortable in your body, we'd like you to call into mind a moment of kindness that someone gave to you or that you shared with somebody else. It can be something small. What made you smile? What made you love? What made you laugh? A moment of kindness in your life. And as you're thinking of that moment in kindness, continuing to breathe in and out, silently repeat each of these phrases. May I be happy. May I be well. May I be safe. May I live with ease. Breathing in and out. Now imagine someone with whom you've had difficulty. Anyone with whom you've had challenges or a conflict. Picture that person in your mind as you continue breathing in and out. And you're going to offer them the same loving kindness you've offered yourself. Breathing in and out. Silently repeat these phrases. May you be happy. May you be well. May you be safe. May you live with the ease of an open heart. Breathe in deeply and breathe out. And when you feel ready, wiggle your fingers and your toes, breathing in and out, and open your eyes. Perhaps we can, thank you. Okay, so we're going from reflection to collection. And as you may know, Sunday Assembly is a totally volunteer donation organization. So we really want to thank you so much for providing the money for this wonderful venue, for all of the things that we need with Sunday Assembly, the child care that we give, all of the vaccines things, the coffee. So please go ahead.
We also have people with square readers walking around. Noah's on the right, Sarah's on the left. So if you prefer to use a debit card or a credit card, we can do that. Here, we can do that at the merchandise table with Jeff in a little bit, and also online. Also, if you see anyone with a green name tag like this, that is the very special VIP treatment for people who have regular donations, which is something you can sign up for online. I think they start as small as $5. Yeah, $5. So you can be a part of how we bring this all together every month for you.
So happy Mother's Day, friends. So glad you're here to share it with all of us. Galen is my tickle boy. Don't touch, hug, kiss, or dare to hold him in public. But as I enter my home at the end of the day, Galen pulls me to our tickle place. I must admit that I get annoyed sometimes because his need is so great. Tickling with Galen is not always my top priority. But mostly I go with him, and we roll around, wrestling and pinning and holding and touching and tickling and touching. Yes, this is all about touch. I wonder when it will end, this year or next. Galen, my boy child, has just turned 10. I have one, maybe two tickle seasons left. That's a part of a much longer piece I wrote 10 years ago called Tickle Season. Even then, I could see that the end result of my mother-child bonding was letting go. And this, my friends, is what I've been thinking about for the past few weeks. That mothering and hungering for connection is a delicate dance between letting go and connecting. We connect in a deep, magical way with our precious, luscious babies. And then we have our toddlers start us in our letting go process as they reach out and say, "Me do it." Our teenagers push us into full-on letting go panic as they shun us and turn to their friends for what we once provided. And then our young adults fall in love, as they should, with another. But we mothers are resilient, and so we turn to our friends and others for connection, always allowing a place in our heart for our children to come home. That end of active full-time mothering that I was dreading 10 years ago is now here. But as much as I've learned to let go, I've also been learning about connecting. My kids are 20 and 24. Rachel is halfway through her master's degree and head over heels in love with her beau, Frederick. And my son, Galen, who brought us mimosas and flowers, he's heading into his junior year in college. And they're learning to connect with the world and their friends in a whole different way. But now I'm connecting with them in a different way. So while I have let them go for the most part, they come back to me as independent adults I had always hoped for. As my children move out into the world, there's space in my life to connect with my husband and with my old friends and with all of you, my new friends, and maybe most importantly, with myself. So I'm finding a lot of joy in both letting go of my children and satisfying my hunger for connection. I'm satisfying it in new ways that I could never foresee that 10 years ago when I wrote Tickle Season. Thank you.
Thank you. And I'm not far behind Marco. I'm just a few years behind when my son was born almost 18 years ago. I was very disappointed to find out there's not an instruction manual. You just get this baby dropped on you and you kind of have to figure it out. I was a single mom for most of my son's life. And I have found that that can be very isolating, particularly because I was a really young mom. So my friends were out partying while I was raising Jonathan. So for me, it's been really important to have other moms in my life and people to look up to, and Marco is one of those people for me, watching other people parent. And that's one of the things I love about Sunday Assembly. It's the thing that we all loved about church when we went to church, is that you have shared experiences in community. So that's what it means to me to be here, like Matt talked about, like Paul and Robert have all talked about. It's just great to have community and to connect with you all today. So I think that we're going to head into a few announcements, and then we're going to close with one more song. Announcements. The Sunday Social is coming up.
So the Sunday Social is Sunday, May 15th, and it's at the Getty Villa. You can sign up at the back or online.
You can sign up online. We also have a Facebook page. It's very exclusive. You have to ask to be a part of it, and then you're in the club. So join our Facebook page. It's great because we have all of our events posted there. They're also on the website, community table, trivia nights, discussion groups. Margo leads a really great Explore Deeper discussion group that a lot of us go to. So that's all happening throughout the month in between our assemblies.
So tonight, I know it's Mother's Day, but tonight we have a really, really special event. Phil Ferguson is in town, and now I've lost you, Phil. Will you stand up and wave? Here's Phil Ferguson, and he will be at CFI, and he will be talking with us about how to deal with our finances in a rational way, and we are really looking forward to that. So please come to CFI in Hollywood at 7, and we will be with Phil Ferguson.
Awesome. So our next assembly is going to be June 19th. Jacqueline Christensen will be our guest speaker, and she is going to be talking about resilience, how we are resilient people. So that'll be a really interesting talk. We also have been working on a fundraising for the Reason Rally. The Reason Rally, this will be the second event in Washington, D.C. It's an opportunity for people of the growing number of nuns to have their voices heard. So we are doing an assembly at Reason Rally. We're super excited, with assemblers from all over the country, and we've been fundraising for that, and very excited to say that we met our $5,000, yes, we met our $5,000 goal, much from the help of Los Angeles assemblers, and that's a national venture, so we're really proud of that, and thank you. Thank you to everyone who donated. We did end up raising the goal after that excitement happened to $6,000, which will allow a little bit more opportunity for funding some people to get there. We're actually going to have the full Sunday Assembly band, which is made up of members from mostly Nashville, but kind of all over, different assemblies performing. So that's going to be great. Shelly Siegel's probably going to be performing there as well. So exciting stuff. Okay, so please stick around afterwards. We're going to have coffee, conversation, hopefully donuts. Are there donuts? In the back of the room.
Yes.
That's my favorite. And then around 1:30, a bunch of us go across the street to the Oinkster. Absolutely everybody is welcome. If you don't know somebody to go across the Oinkster with, come say hello. You will know people when you get there. It's a very friendly group, so please join us for that.
And thank you so much for Roger Eager, Shelagh Ratner, and Matt Rockel, and of course, Sean serving mimosas. Thank you. Thank you to our video and audio volunteers, all the rest of our volunteers, and thanks for making another great Sunday Assembly. And especially thank you to Paul Svenson, who has come up for a final song.
So the Warblers, they're going to come back up to the stage. One more song, backed by popular demand. It was mostly my demand. We are going to be rocking out to Journey now. So if you feel the spirit, if you feel the spirit of the 80s cheese moving your soul, please come up. Please come dance, sing with us. Just don't stop believing.
Here we go.
Just a small town girl, living in a lonely world. She took the midnight train going everywhere. Just a city boy, born and raised in South Detroit. He took the midnight train going anywhere. Singer in a smoky room, smell of wine and cheap perfume. For a smile they can share the night. It goes on and on and on and on. Strangers waiting. Working hard to get my fill. Everybody wants a thrill. Paying anything to roll the dice just one more time.
Some will win,
some will lose. Some were born to sing the blues. Oh, the movie, it never ends. It goes on and on and on. Up and down the boulevard, their shadows searching in the night. Streetlights, people, fighting to find emotion, hiding somewhere in the night. Oh. Don't stop believing. Hold on to the feeling. Streetlights, people. Oh, come on, sing it now. Don't stop believing. Hold on to the feeling. Streetlights, people. Oh, one more time. Don't stop believing. Hold on to the feeling. Street lights, people.
Until next time, live better, help often, and wonder more. Thank you.